Okay, so I want to reiterate, anyone has any questions about the project, the submission for the initial topic selection is today, so you have to post it on Carmen. So any other question about homework? I saw several emails over the weekend, but nobody is asking me any question in the class. Any questions about project? So all of you have figured out what topic you want to do the project in? No, kind of. So one of the things that I mentioned over the weekend was you can also pick one of the Kaggle challenges as your project. So Kaggle seems to be a fairly difficult challenge. I mean, those challenges are fairly difficult. You have to deal with actual data, and actual data is messy. It's not like homework problem. Okay, so if you choose Kaggle project, make sure that you understand the time commitment behind the Kaggle project. And the Kaggle project is not necessarily for this homework. For this course, you should also think of it as a way to learn how to deal with real data. Okay, so there is a little bit more than what you are doing actually for the project if you take up Kaggle, but it's also because you learn important things while you are doing some of these Kaggle based projects. Okay, so at the end you only have to write a 6-page report. Okay, and in those 6 pages you have to specify what exactly you did. And what is it that you learned, or what kind of new algorithms you figured out that are useful in a specific domain like battery management for autonomous vehicle, or battery management for some hybrid vehicles, or optimization of water systems, or natural gas network, and things of that nature. So that's the kind of, it's a good learning exercise for you. It's not necessarily to convince me that you did something, but it is, I should be convinced after reading the paper, the project report that you write, I should be able to read it and say that, well, you learned something new in this particular project, which might be useful for your future career. Yes. Yeah, you can include either as a footnote or as a reference in the end. Okay. So we'll get started with today's class. I want to continue our discussion about projection theorem. So we had a convex set. This is my convex set. I have a point z, and I want to find the point x star that's closest to this point z. Okay, and x star should be in the set x. So formally, the projection of z is argmin of x in x norm of x minus z square. Okay, so if I pick a point inside the set x, the projection is that point itself. Okay, but if I pick a point outside the set, you have to project it back onto the set. Okay, so let's look at some simple projection. So let's say my set X is, so examples, my set X is X in Rn such that norm of X is less than equal to R. Okay, and I have a point Z, I want to project it. What's the projection, assuming that the norm of z is less than equal to r and norm of z is greater than r? Okay, so there are two cases here. One case is that the point z is in this set itself, in this sphere itself, and the other case is when z is outside the sphere. Okay, you want a picture? Here is a picture. Okay, so this looks like a sphere, so it is a sphere. And I have a point z here, and I have a point z here. So what's the projection of this z? Z itself? Okay, now what's the projection of this z? This right here. Any thoughts? sorry, scale it. So that would be R z over norm of z. Okay, so it should be this point x. So this is my origin. I draw a line from origin to z, and this is my x star. This is the point that's closest to z, which lies within this sphere x. Okay. The other way to figure out why this should be the optimal point is to look at the hyperplane. So this is a differentiable surface. So I look at the hyperplane, and it's making 90 degrees with respect to that hyperplane. Okay, I look at the hyperplane that is tangent to this point x star, and the line going from z to x star should make a right angle with respect to this hyperplane. Okay, now, so this projection is a fairly simple operation in this particular case. Let's look at another convex set x in Rn such that alpha I less than equal to xi less than equal to beta I for all I. Now I have a point z. I want to find the projection of z. How do I get the projection? So first of all, let me write down the obvious one. If z is in x, then the projection is z itself. Okay, but what should I write here when z is not in x? Okay, so let's consider a special case to find out the more general result. So I have this three dimension. This is x, this is y, and this is z dimension. And I have a box constraint here. Okay, so this is my box here, and I have a point, let's say a point here. Okay, this is my z. What would the projection be of this point z? Any thoughts? My question is, this is a box, this is my point z, which is outside the box. I want to project it onto the box. So which point should be the projection of that point? This point?
The point that if we draw perpendicular from z on the surface.
So that's this point. Okay, so your claim is this point is the projection of z, right? Okay, that's true. Okay, so this is the projection of z. Why is this a projection of z? If you look at any other vector within this box, so let's pick any point x, this is my x star. And if you look at z minus x star transpose x minus x star, it's less than equal to 0. Okay? So what's the coordinate of this point? So the coordinate of that point is z1, z2, and beta 3. Okay, so that's the coordinate. So let me write the coordinate z1, z2, beta 3. That's the coordinate of this point. So in general, if you have a box, So if z is not in x, then plus I equals alpha I if zi is less than equal to alpha I, beta I if zi is greater than equal to beta I, and zi if zi is in alpha I beta I. Okay, so the ith component of this projected variable would be chosen according to this fashion. You can call it z1, z2, z3. Okay, is this clear? Okay, so in these two cases, projection is a fairly simple operation. You don't have to do a lot. It's just looking at, so in this case, it's scaling. In this case, looking at individual components and seeing their magnitude, compare it with alpha I, beta I, and then figure out what the projected variable should be. Any other question? Any question on this? No? So let's make it a bit harder. So now my x is x in Rn such that Ax equal to 0. Okay, and I want to project C, which is not in X. Again, if C is in X, then C itself is a projection of C onto X. But now I'm assuming that C is not in X. So what should the projected variable be? Yes, A has full rank. A in R m cross n. M is less than n, A is full rank. Okay, so you are saying that C, what is it? A transpose A inverse? Oh. C. Let's check. Okay, so this is a subspace, right? So remember, for subspace, the projection was X star Z plus if and only if. Anyone remembers what that was? Z minus X star transpose X is equal to 0 for all X in X. That was the fourth part of the projection theorem, if X is subspace. Okay, so let's see. You are claiming that this is the projection of C. So then I take C minus A transpose A. By the way, A transpose A is not invertible. You can just pseudo. Okay, now you're making it more difficult. Okay, fine. Let's assume this is pseudo inverse. Okay, so A transpose A inverse A transpose C transpose X is equal to, what is this equal to? All I know is that AX is equal to 0. right? So what do I have? I have, can someone help me with this? C transpose I minus A transpose A inverse A transpose multiplied by X. This doesn't seem to be vanishing. So it doesn't seem to be vanishing. It's not equal to zero. Okay, well, no, the solution is very similar but slightly different. Okay, so let's do that. Well, let's do that here. So my projection of C is argmin norm of X minus C square such that AX is equal to 0. So my X star for this particular optimization is given by minus, not minus, I minus A transpose inverse, so we don't need pseudo inverse, AC. Okay, so let's see why, I mean, let's look at that, whether it satisfies that condition or not. So C minus X star is equal to A transpose inverse A, C. Is that right? Yeah. So what is C minus X star transpose X equal to? Do I have to do it? Okay. C transpose A transpose A transpose inverse AX. What is this equal to? Zero, right? Remember, this is equal to zero. AX is equal to zero for every X in X. Okay, so since AX is equal to zero for every X in X. So this indeed is the solution. Yes. This, an oracle told me this is the answer. Okay, you will be able to solve this class of problem once we study Lagrange multipliers later on. But right now, just someone proposed this solution and all I have to do is check the sufficient condition from there. At the end, right. I have thought about that answer. It doesn't seem like that's going to be the case, and the reason is because A is an A is a matrix in M cross N. So if A was an N cross N matrix, then what you're saying is true. But because it's an M cross N matrix, in order to get the correct dimensions, you have to go through this entire procedure. Okay. Any other question? Yes. Rotation. No, I don't think so. So here is my hyperplane. Here is my C. All I am doing is projecting C onto this plane, so that it's so that it creates a 90 degree. It is exactly at right angle with respect to this plane. I mean, the when you multiply a vector by a matrix, it automatically means you're scaling the vector as well as you're rotating the vector. But in this case, that rotation and scaling has to be done in a very specific fashion, so that the final vector is making a right angle. This vector, that the vector from X star to C, is making a right angle with the entire plane. Any question? No? Okay. So now we move on to the more interesting topic of what is known as gradient descent methods for constrained optimization. So the class of algorithms we are interested in would look something like this. We want xk plus 1 to be equal to xk plus alpha k dk. Naturally, we want the value at xk plus 1 to be less than equal to the value at xk. So f of xk plus 1 should be equal to, should be less than, strictly less than f at xk. So how would we choose the direction dk? So we still want dk to be such that the gradient of fxk transpose dk should be less than 0. Okay, we still want that condition to hold true. And since we are looking at a convex optimization problem, not a convex optimization, we are looking at the constraint set is convex in this case. We would assume that dk is given by some vector x bar k in x minus xk. Okay, so if you look at this set, this is my xk, this is my x bar k, so I want dk to be of this, to be of this this type. Okay, so xk minus x bar k. Sorry, x bar k minus xk, where x bar k is some other value within the set itself. So the attractive thing with this choice of direction is that xk plus 1, so as long as your alpha k is in 0, 1, so if your dk satisfies this constraint and alpha k is between 0 and 1, you are guaranteed that xk plus 1 will also be within the set. Okay, so you are not going outside the set under any circumstance. So we will focus our attention on directions of this type. Dk equals x bar k minus xk. Okay, so all of you understand. So if this is my dk and alpha k, then this would imply that xk plus 1 will be in the constraint set x. Okay, so how can we choose alpha k? So suppose somebody gave me a value of x bar k. I wrote an algorithm and that gave me a value of x bar k, such that if I look at this direction dk and I transpose it with the gradient of f at xk, I get a value which is strictly less than 0. Okay, so how would you choose this alpha k? There are some options how to choose alpha k. Option one is using limited minimization rule, which means that alpha k is argmin alpha in 0, 1 f of xk plus alpha dk. We are restricting ourselves to interval 0, 1. Second, we can take alpha k equals to 1 for all k. That's constant step size. And the third one is Armijo's rule. So we pick a sigma in 0, 1. We pick a beta in 0, 1. And then let mk be the smallest m greater than equal to 0 such that okay, so this is something we have already seen in the context of unconstrained optimization. We have already seen in the context of unconstrained optimization, and this also we have already seen in the context of unconstrained optimization. Yes, you can use bisection method to do that. In the case of conditional gradient method, if you remember, we were able to compute alpha k exactly. So either you use bisection method or you enumerate all the values of alpha between 0 and 1 at the interval of 0.1, and then
it has to do it every iteration, right?
It has to, yeah.
So it takes a lot of time.
Well, if you have to enumerate, then yes, it takes a lot of time. If you have to use bisection method, it might be much faster. And of course, if you have a closed form expression, then that's the fastest method to get alpha k.
So constant would be a better choice in some cases?
Yes, in some cases. That's where you have three different methods, right? So Armijo rule might make sense in some cases where you have highly non-convex problem, right? And constant would make sense in some other case.
Why do we consider alpha to be on a closed set? Because like if we choose 0, for 1 I understand, but if we choose 0, then we're never going to.
Oh yeah, that's true. I mean, in which case you might already be at a stationary point. You might already be at a local minimum.
But you'll never know if you can't Is the alpha be a VK term always be zero?
Yeah, but the idea is if alpha, well, in reality, yes, you can always make sure that alpha is strictly greater than zero. But suppose you get the value of alpha that is very close to zero, 0.01 or 0.001. It's very likely, it's highly likely that along that direction, you're not descending anymore. Okay, you are only ascending, in which case you are already at the local minimum. Okay, if that is true for all other directions, then that means you are at a local minimum. That's a very good point. Yes?
For stochastic version, the zero would be important, right? Because even if we are not taking step in one direction, there might be some step to take.
In stochastic case, yes. Yes, so you might be, in the stochastic case, you might be at a local minimum of the function that you have sampled, but you might not be at the global, at a local minimum of the global function. Okay, so now let's study a few methods by which we can find that x bar k. Remember, my dk is equal to x bar k minus xk. So how do we find x bar k knowing that we are standing at xk at the moment? So first method is conditional. Gradient method. Okay? In which case you define x bar k equals argmin x in capital X gradient of f xk transpose x minus xk. So what's the intuition behind picking this x bar k?
Is this the Frank-Wolf algorithm?
Yes, this is Frank-Wolf algorithm. Oh. Okay, this is also known as Frank-Wolf algorithm. So what is the idea here? Remember, this is same as okay, this is the same as minimizing the gradient transpose D along all feasible directions in the set. So this is my set, this is my xk, this is my one feasible direction, another feasible direction. Okay, all of these are feasible direction. So I want to minimize the gradient transpose D along all these feasible directions, and I want to pick the direction that it minimizes this inner product. Okay? Remember that we wanted gradient of fxk transpose x bar k minus xk to be strictly less than zero. Okay, recall. Then we are descending. If we choose our x bar k in such a manner, then we are descending. So why not just minimize this inner product itself so that you probably are at the most negative point possible after you have scanned all possible feasible directions within the set. Okay? Is that clear? Does that explanation make sense? Okay, so you want to minimize this. You want to minimize this along all feasible directions D. Yes. Which one? DK?
Yeah, the DK.
What do you mean scale it? No, you don't have to. You don't have to. So suppose this direction seems to be the best direction, so that it minimizes along all possible x, then this will become your d. This entire length will become your d or dk. So this will be your x bar k. So your point is that you will go in a direction that maximizes your inner product, right? So I'm saying that you don't have to normalize it. Let it go wherever it has to go, whatever maximizes the inner product. Okay? But you will control the length of dk using one of these Armio's rule or limited minimization rule or something, okay? So you still have one more control variable when you're choosing the step size. Okay. Let's look at an example. Yes. I mean, so you want to have this inner product to be strictly less than zero, right? So if you minimize this variable, this function of x along all possible x, you are assured that you will have at least strictly less than zero unless you are standing at a local minimum, right? Any other question? So in all these cases, when you arrive at xk, you have to check the first order necessary condition or sufficient condition to know whether you are at a local minimum or not. Okay? What if the optimal value turns out to be greater than or equal to zero? Okay? In which case you are already standing at a optimal point, and if you take any step, you're essentially trying to move in a direction that might either keep the cost constant or it might increase the cost. Okay? So you have to check for the optimality at every point of time in these cases. Okay, so I wanted to do an example, and the example is my set X is X in Rn, X greater than or equal to 0, summation of Xi equals to R, I equals 1 to n. This is known as simplex. Okay, so we want to minimize we want to solve this problem, which is the same as minimizing xk Okay, so I want to minimize this objective function. It's a linear program, right? Because this is a constant. This is a linear set of constraints, so this is a linear program. And what I want to argue is that this minimization problem is the same as I don't want to write it as equal to, because it's not equal, but it's equivalent to minimize x over x, summation of del f over del xi, evaluated at xk, multiplied by xi. Okay? Why is that? Why should these two minimization problems be equivalent? The second term is a constant term. Okay? So if you look at, if you go back to this particular optimization problem, it can be written as argmin of x in x, gradient of fxk transpose x minus gradient of fxk transpose xk. Okay? And this term is not a function of x anymore. Not a function of x. Okay, so if you have an optimization problem where there are some terms that are dependent on x and some terms that are independent of x, if you drop the independent terms, it doesn't change the argmin of the objective function itself. So the argmin here remains the same as argmin x in x gradient of fxk transpose x. Okay? Doesn't change. Remember that the minimum value changes, but the argument doesn't change. Yes?
The gradient fxk is also constant,
right? Yes, but it gets multiplied by x.
Basically, just we are optimizing, minimizing.
We are just minimizing this part, which is a function of x, not this part, which is not a function of x. So in general, if you want to minimize f of x plus c, or you want to find the argmin of fx plus c, it's the same as finding the argmin of f of x. Okay? Because the c part, the constant part, doesn't participate in the optimization.
I mean to say that even after removing c, the fx in this case would be just kx, some constant into x.
Yes. Yes.
It will be minimum for just the lower formula of x. Because,
what?
I mean, depending upon the constant is positive, then this term would be minimum only for the smallest value of h.
Yes. Yes. That's it. So it's the same argument. The argument doesn't change. Going from this objective function to this objective function, the argument doesn't change. The value changes, but the argument doesn't change. Is that part, does this make sense to everyone? Okay. So because of that, I can think of this minimization problem to be the same as this minimization problem. Even though the value, optimal value, might differ, the argmin is going to remain the same. And what we are interested in is the argmin. Okay? So let's see. So what I want you to think is that what values of x in this set capital X, so remember this is capital X, this is the set, okay, it's a simplex. So for what value of X in the simplex is this objective function minimized? Okay, so what is my X bar K here? Okay, let me call this CI. Have I used CI before? No, right? Okay, so let me call it CI. So what I want to do is minimize summation CI XI, I equals 1 to n, where X is in set X. Or rather, I should write that XI greater than equal to 0, and summation of XI is equal to R, I equals 1 to n. So what should be the argument? What should be the argument here? I want someone else to answer. What is the argument here? Any thoughts? Guesses? Who wants to be brave? Okay, no brave people in the class. Come on, I want an answer from someone. What's the answer to this question? You can be wrong. Yeah. You want to give it a shot? X or C?
C.
C. Okay. So, let me call J star to be argmin of I, Ci, and X star would be 0, 0, R, 0, 0, 0, and this R is at the J starth position. Okay, and the reason is if you pick a value of Ci, if you pick an X star which has a value greater than 0 at any of the point where Ci is greater than the minimum of Ci, then you can always reduce the cost by moving this value and putting it, moving this weight and putting it onto the index at which Ci is minimized. Okay, so this is the minimum value. And so my question is, for this class of sets, doing this computation is fairly easy, right? For this kind of set, so if you are doing some optimization, you're solving a nonlinear optimization over a simplex, then at every point of time, you have to find the argmin. You have to find the argmin of this optimization problem. So how will you find the argmin? You will look at the gradient of f with respect to xi evaluated at xk. You will look at this gradient at all indices 1 to n, and whatever is the minimum value, whatever index has the minimum value, you put an r there, and that becomes your argmin of this optimization problem. Okay, is that clear? So it's a fairly, if you look at it computationally, doesn't take much time to find the minimum of the minimum index of all these real numbers.
So is X star X bar K?
Oh yeah, this is X bar K. So yes, so X bar of, let me just write it as X bar of K. So X bar of K looks something like this. Okay. So I want to say a little bit about this conditional gradient method, which is as follows. Well, I want to give you some intuition. I just don't want to state the fact. So let me give you some intuition. So remember, this is a linear program problem, right? Not a linear program, but look at this problem. Minimization of gradient of fxk transpose x, where x is in set capital X. Okay, so this is linear program. This is linear, not linear program, linear objective function. Okay, so there is a very famous theorem in mathematics. It's called Krein-Milman theorem, which has a finite dimensional counterpart, which I forgot the name about. But what it says is, if you have a concave objective function, so I want to minimize concave function over convex set, okay, then solution is at the boundary. Okay, and it's not necessarily a boundary, it's called an extreme point, but I don't want to get into this idea of extreme point. But what it basically means, well, let me just write it as extreme point because that's more precise at an extreme point. So what is an extreme point? Okay, if this is my convex set, then these are my extreme points. The points that cannot be written as convex combination of any other two points within the set. Okay, so this is an extreme point because I can't write this point as a convex combination of any other two points within the set. Okay, that's the definition of extreme point. And if I want to minimize a concave function over a convex set, a concave function, what is a concave function? A linear objective function is a concave function, right? So it's a concave function, and I want to minimize it over a convex set, then the solution would always lie at an extreme point. Okay? Does that make sense? So my x is convex, I have a concave objective function. So my argmin is going to be one of these points. Now let's say you're standing at this xk and the gradient is in this direction. So this is my negative gradient fxk. Okay? If you solve that problem every time, it will either try to take you along this direction or it will try to take you along this direction. Okay? But not in this direction. Even though your optimal solution might be here, it will try to take you in this direction, and then once you reach here, then it will start taking you in this direction. Okay, instead of taking you directly towards this direction. Okay, so that's the drawback of conditional gradient method because of this strong result which comes from real analysis, that if you want to minimize a concave function over a convex set, your solution will always be at an extreme point. Okay, so instead of going here, you will go here, and then once you reach here, then you start descending along this direction instead of going directly to this point, which might be a candidate minimum solution. Looks like the time is up. Okay, so that's what I wanted to talk about conditional gradient. You will have much better result in conditional gradient if you had large number of constraints. So your x had a large number of inequality constraints, then your conditional gradient would work well. Otherwise, with small number of constraints, you're better off using some of the other methods that we will discuss in subsequent lectures. All right, thank you.